Welcome to the East Asia by Rhoads Murphy chapter summary podcast at the Historian's Eye. Please subscribe, and if you'd like to be notified when new episodes appear, click the bell icon. Chapter 8, The Qing in Prosperity and Decline. Section 1, The Rise of the Qing Dynasty. The revolt of the three feudatories was a civil war that emerged against the Manchu, or Qing dynasty, in 1673. Due to this revolt, it took the Qing until 1681 before they controlled the entire country. Wu Songhui, the former Ming general who had used the Manchus to suppress Li Shiqing's uprising, was rewarded with large tracts of land in the southwest and became wealthy through trade. With the aid of his large army, he rebelled against the Qing. Two additional former Manchu collaborators joined him. Between the three of them, they controlled the majority of South China. Taiwan, or Formosa, became the headquarters for the Ming loyalist rebel named Jing Chinggan from 1624 to 1663. The Dutch were driven from the island. His son, who also joined the revolt of the three feudatories, succeeded him. In 1683, the Qing occupied Taiwan and eliminated the remaining rebels after almost 40 years of civil war. After the Manchus had succeeded in ending resistance, they worked towards gaining Chinese support and forming a partnership with the country's population. This worked far more successfully than the alienated Mongol approach. The Manchu dynasty lasted far longer than any other dynasty achieved through barbarian conquest, and they were the only group except the Mongols to control the entire country. Non-Chinese rulers became sinicized. They viewed Chinese civilization as the only imperial model and relied heavily on Chinese employees and technical experts. Like other foreign conquerors, the Manchus had already adopted many of the Chinese practices before succeeding in obtaining power over the country. They had moved away from nomadic herding and developed an agricultural economy, adopted Confucianism, and had already mirrored the Manchurian government on the Chinese imperial system. Despite this, they kept their spoken language and adopted the Uyghur script to write the secret history of the Mongols. Narachi was already in the process of adopting much of Chinese culture. Under Narachi and his son Hong Taiji, from 627 to 643, the process of Sinization gained pace. In 1635 and 1636 respectively, Hong Taiji gave his people the name Manchu, and his dynasty the Qing. The Manchus were only about 1% of the total population. Emperor Shunzi succeeded Hong Taiji. His uncle Dorgan served as his regent. Kangzi, Shunzi's son, was also a minor. Qing rule. Eunuchs were kept from power. The banners were initially Manchu tribe groups, but then others were added, including Chinese and Mongol. The Qing territory grew to include Outer Mongolia, Xinjiang, Tibet, and the Chosun Kingdom. Administrators. Primarily, Chinese collaborators held government posts. The imperial exam system based on Confucian classics continued to supply the majority of officials. In Beijing, the General Secretariat was staffed by Chinese and Manchus. Most Manchus came from the area of Manchuria, which had followed the Chinese cultural model for centuries. The Manchus tried to prevent immigration into Manchuria as a step towards preserving their homeland. The emperor had complete oversight of the government. The emperors alone had the authority and responsibility to appoint all officials, preside over civil and military servants, approve all policy matters, as well as sign all death sentences and hear appeals. Officials sent memorials directly to the emperor. As with previous dynasties, the system worked well so long as the emperors were strong, responsible leaders. Over 90% of China remained rural, therefore outside of the administrative capital and 18 provincial capitals. These areas primarily governed themselves as a Confucian self-regulated society. 2,000 postal stations dotted the imperial road system. Available historical documentation on the Qing dynasty is more plentiful than previous periods. This is partly because the period is closer to us, but also because Qing China was well respected and written about by Europeans. Philosophers of the European Enlightenment were impressed by the Confucian emphasis on morality and education. Legal scholars were also influenced by the Qing law code, particularly its basis in Confucian ethics. The first 150 years of Qing rule, especially the reigns of Kangxi and Qinlong, was a period of population growth and cultural brilliance. The population approximately tripled from around 1650. Agriculture and commerce continued to grow alongside the population until the 18th century. The government promoted technological advances and increased agricultural production. New land was cultivated to support the rising population, particularly in the south and southwest, often at the expense of indigenous non-Han populations inhabiting those regions. Areas in the southeast were cleared for tea plantations. Foreign and domestic trade continued to expand beyond new levels of wealth. Merchant guilds grew in number, gaining greater social and political influence. The trade balance was in favor of China, bringing silver in exchange for Chinese exports. Potatoes, corn, peanuts, tobacco, and cotton supplemented more traditional crops coming through Manila. Improvements in rice cultivation and increased production encouraged the growth of China's population and trade. Irrigation of rice fields was refined. These improvements could feed even the greatly increasing population. Qing population reports were used for both the calculation of taxes as well as for evidence of a prosperous empire. 142 million inhabitants in 1741 and 432 million in 1851. Kangxi. Culturally Chinese, Kangxi was also a poet. He supported the arts and education. He expanded the imperial kilns, initially for himself, but eventually also for export. Kangxi commissioned a new encyclopedia and a dictionary of the Chinese language and increased the number of private and public schools. He also continued his own education by learning about the West with the aid of Jesuit tutors. Kangxi was also an effective military leader. He supervised the acquisition of Taiwan, restored Chinese control over northern Manchuria and Xinjiang, as well as established Chinese authority in Tibet. The negotiation of the Treaty of Nerchinsk in 1689 with Russia over northern territory in Manchuria marked the first significant treaty with the Western power. The Qing clearly emerged as victors. As with previous dynasties, less attention was paid along coastal borders. Westerners like the Portuguese, Dutch, and English were viewed as sea barbarians, equivalent to bandits and pirates. This proved to be a fatal error as Europe began to emerge as a colonial power. At Kangxi's death, his son and chosen heir became mentally unfit. Conflict emerged among siblings. Yong Jin announced himself emperor. He was a capable ruler, establishing the Grand Council. At his death, Yong Jin left the throne to Kangxi's grandson, Qinlong. Qinlong revered his grandfather and sought to rule along a similar model. He supported developments in arts and education, with the exception of ordering the destruction of 2,300 books considered unorthodox. As a military leader, he succeeded where previous rulers had failed and permanently subdued the Mongols. He conquered Tibet and established tributary authority over Nepal, northern Burma, and northern Vietnam. In his youth, Qinlong oversaw every aspect of governance. He Shen. In old age, Qinlong delegated more and more authority. He Shen was the chief favorite of Qinlong and was appointed Grand Counselor during the end of his reign. He Shen took control of the government and extorted about $1.5 billion. He continued to have substantial power within the government until Qinlong's death. Without a responsible and capable emperor, the administrative system had deteriorated and become susceptible to corruption. The White Lotus sect led a rebellion in 1796, only subdued after He Shen's fall. He Shen's rise to power also reflects the importance of personal connections within China's government and society as a whole. Confucianism held family connections as the highest duty. Therefore, it was common practice for officials to divert funds in order to support family and friends. He Shen simply went too far. As with all power based on personal relationships, it came to an end with the death of Qinlong when he was pushed out of office. Society and Culture in Hai Qing. Family and Marriage. Eldest sons were responsible for important family rituals. They traditionally cared for the parents and the family ancestors, including the arrangement of funeral preparations and maintenance of family shrines. Family continuity was crucial, and thus the role of sons was key. Young women had little, if any, say in who they married. Often, the only available method of avoiding marriage was suicide, the latter being a common motif in stories. Once married, they were more or less treated as servants, and they maintained the lowest status within the family until the birth of a son. Sons were considered essential for family continuity and security. They were the primary purpose of marriage. Marriage was patrilocal. A bride entering a family fell to the lowest status until the birth of a son. Women were invariably blamed for failing to do so. People were raised to put individual desires aside for the greater family interest. This included marriage, which was most often arranged by the family for its benefit. Child rearing. It was common practice for parents to wait until children were at least 1 year of age before officially naming them. It was considered bad luck to get one's hopes up, and parents often publicly pretended that their children were deficient in some way as a method to dissuade the gods from taking their children to the heavens. Children were generally taught to obey. However, boys were indulged until the age of 7. At 7 years of age, it became important to start training children for adulthood. Therefore, obedience and discipline replaced previous indulgence. It has been observed that child-rearing practices have contributed to shaping the adult reality in East Asian society. Girls are raised to accept their lower status within the family, and boys are brought up to be extremely dependent. The status of women. Women primarily held subordinate roles within the family and society. Widows were not expected to marry, and suicide was not uncommon. Female babies were often killed at or shortly after birth. Some were sold as servants or concubines to wealthy households. This was often considered a way to save one's child from impoverishment. However, while most women remained publicly subordinate, most were privately very powerful, especially if they were older and had borne sons. Wives played a key role in providing family continuity, and traditionally, most managed the family finances. They were no less important as men to the social network of East Asia, but they had few public rewards and experienced discrimination based on their gender. Manchu women had more opportunity for public roles. It is important to note that Vietnam's close relationship with Southeast Asia created more equal status for women. Also in Japan, women writers were very important and socially accepted. Women were rarely permitted to have a formal education. They learned at home, and their education focused on how to be a good wife, mother, and daughter-in-law. Elite women were expected to learn how to read and write, but this was achieved through informal channels. For the peasantry, the majority of the population, women provided agricultural labor and were largely responsible for cottage industries, like producing cloth for sale or barter. Sexual customs. Ideally, women were supposed to be modest and chaste. Upper-class women were rarely seen in public, in part because of foot binding. Elite culture patronized the production of erotic art and literature. Courtesans were also commonplace, though it is a misconception that their role was solely sexual. They were often well-educated and weren't expected to provide witty and intelligent conversation, as well as perform sexual favors. Prostitutes, who dealt primarily with sex, far outnumbered courtesans. The majority of the population had little privacy, therefore sex was primarily a brief interaction for procreation. A clear double standard operated, whereby married women were expected to be monogamous, yet male infidelity was tolerated. In China, unmarried women had to be virgins and were commonly rejected if discovered otherwise. Law, crime, and punishment. In East Asia, the correction of behavior and reform through re-education was stressed over the Western notion of retribution and punishment. Shame was the most commonly used method to enforce moral codes. It was thought that individuals could behave appropriately in order to avoid shame, and/or that shame provided sufficient re-education of behavior. Antisocial behavior and criminality were viewed more as a failure of society rather than of only the individual. Therefore, it could be corrected, especially with family help. Banditry was a common form of criminal behavior. Piracy along the coast often arose from the proximity of poor areas and rich opportunities. Some bandits turned to rebellion. Banditry was considered a response to absolute poverty and a sign of problematic government. Many had religious underpinnings. Laws were enforced and punishments exacted through a civil court system. There was no prior assumption of guilt or innocence, no lawyers, and evidence, including the testimony of witnesses, determined outcomes. Confessions of guilt were only acceptable evidence to prove an individual guilty. Therefore, torture was often used to extract confessions. Trial by ordeal was also used. Death was a punishment for most major crimes and often included some forms of dismemberment. Confucian thought held the body sacred, and producing disfigurements to the body were considered especially shameful. Imprisonment also occurred. Another common punishment was forcing individuals to wear kange. This was a heavy wooden collar shaped so that the individual wearing it could not feed oneself. Having to depend on others was thought to bring great shame and re-educate behavior. Punishments were primarily viewed as deterrents for potential criminals and also to bring shame to the family. Re-education and reform was often stressed in dealing with offenders. The East Asian social network of collective responsibility provided a strong deterrent. In fact, 90% of all disputes and minor crimes never entered the formal court system. They were settled through informal networks of family and community. Despite its problems, Western scholars have concluded that justice was achieved more consistently in China than in the West during this period. As in the West, the justice system was most often harsher to those who had little than the upper classes, which relied on social status and personal connections. The later Qing, decline and inertia. During the 18th century, the Qing experienced the height of its reign, but even before the death of Qinlong, the dynasty had begun to decline. Prosperity continued for most of the population, and with the exception of He Shen, the government remained efficient and well-organized. Art and literature throve, the latter being illustrated by The Dream of the Red Chamber. Problems arose as the growing population began to exceed that of the available opportunities. The government increased the number of official posts by 25%, but the population was growing more rapidly, doubling than tripling. A large number of well-educated young men became frustrated with failing the increasingly rigid exam system. And many of the more fortunate who had passed exams were looked over and not called to office. This created a population of ambitious, well-educated, but unemployed and frustrated young men. They formed rebellion groups, the numbers of which increased rapidly after 1785. Degrees and positions came to be sold. The government was further weakened by the fact that existing officials became responsible for governing larger populations. A magistrate from the Song Dynasty was responsible for administering a population of about 80,000 individuals. By the end of the 19th century, Qing officials were responsible for around 250,000. This rose to 300,000 by the 19th century. The situation became impossible for a single magistrate and his staff to govern. This resulted in the rise of local gentry, landlords, merchant guilds, and occasionally criminal groups who became increasingly important. Contributing to the increased administrative concerns was the fact that by the end of the 18th century, increases in food production were outpaced by population increases. Income levels stabilized and then began to fall. Banditry and rebellion became rampant. The White Lotus Society reemerged, leading a major uprising in 1796. It took until 1804 for the government to suppress the rebellion, place strain on the treasury, and demonstrated a decline in the effectiveness of the military, which struggled to overtake the rebels. New foreign pressure. The emerging problem remained manageable well into the 19th century, but they did continue to grow. Westerners continued to seek trading privileges with China, where they were still considered subservient barbarians. They were understood through the tributary system, since that was the only established system China had historically used with foreigners. For Westerners, trade was strictly limited to the port of Guangzhou and to a limited period of about 6 months each year. Foreign merchants found these restrictions frustrating, since they understood China as a vast marketplace with a variety of merchants. Both the Dutch and the British, who viewed themselves as equally powerful states, tried to negotiate for expanding trade access and failed. The Englishman James Flint tried to sail to ports north of Guangzhou, but found himself deported. By the last decade of the 18th century, the English had begun to find these limitations intolerable. In 1793, King George III of England sent Viscount Macartney to Chinlong with the hopes of negotiating expanded trade. Since neither Europe nor China understood much about each other, their awkward interaction failed to improve trade relations. The emperor felt obligated to accept the tributary gifts, though they were viewed as of poor quality. Macartney refused to perform the ritual submission of kowtow and was only granted an informal meeting with the emperor where they did not face each other. Successive attempts by both the British and the Dutch failed to improve foreign trade relations, and interaction with the West remained limited and highly regulated. This only contributed to further frustration for the West. Lord Amherst came in 1816 with no more success than Macartney. Foreign merchants remained confined to Guangzhou. Qing glory and technological backwardness. The emperors that had followed Kangxi and Qinlong, while not as powerful as successful, succeeded in renewing a sense of honesty and responsibility to governance after the corruption of He Shen. However, the state experienced a series of failures. There was no adequate long-term response to the economic pressures of an increasing population. Slowly but surely, the Chinese economy declined. Rural poverty grew in certain areas as the population increased more rapidly than agricultural production. Agricultural technology had peaked. The only option for China was to look towards new technology, particularly the now superior technology developed in the West. However, the government failed to realize this. It continued to resist the adoption of anything foreign and viewed such ideas as an unnecessary disruption to the current system, which was considered superior. This was most likely furthered by the fact that the Qing dynasty was a result of foreign invasion. The current government felt that added pressure to continue preserving China's ancient ways. Commerce continued to flourish and grow, but the rise of an urban merchant class in China developed along a different path than the West. In China, the merchants and their guilds never developed into an independent group of entrepreneurs who sought to change the system to their advantage. Wealth was acquired through obtaining large shares of existing production, rather than increasing production and venturing into new markets. Money was invested primarily in land, money lending, and luxurious living. Investments in new technology that could increase production rarely occurred, as they often did in the West. While China had pioneered many important technological and medical advances, an emphasis on Confucian classics limited scientific inquiry. The successful scientific and technological innovations developed by the West rested primarily on the melding of theory, design, experiment, and practice. China was further limited from engaging in such developments due to its traditional division of labor. Artisans, while highly skilled, remained primarily illiterate, while the elite educated class labored with their minds. Already so successful, China had less of a need to break with its past as Europe did as it rose to power. Unfortunately for China, Europe's success coincided with the last third of Qing rule, historically a period of decline for all dynasties. Two major problems faced rulers: the huge population and increasing threats from foreigners. By the 19th century, corruption within the government had weakened its power greatly. Influential and wealthy families increasingly escaped taxation, placing a larger burden on the peasantry and leading to increased banditry and rebellion. China also continued to concentrate on its northern land frontier and failed to realize the seriousness of the new sea barbarian threat along its coast. Opium War with Great Britain. By the 1820s, more silver was leaving China to pay for the importation of opium than was entering the country through its exportation of tea, porcelain, and silk. This created an imbalance in the economy, especially since Chinese taxpayers were required to pay in silver. Originally imported from Persia, a market for imported opium from British India developed. Opium, a highly addictive drug, was originally used medicinally, but became used heavily as a recreational drug in the late 1700s. In response to the problem, the government declared the use and trade of opium a capital offense. Unfortunately, the law was widely ignored and proved ineffective. The Opium War, better described as the Anglo-Chinese War of 1839 to 1842, followed an attempt to control the trade. While the opium trade was the immediate cause of war, the arrogance of both sides was the long-term cause. An imperial commissioner was sent to Guangzhou in 1839 in order to stop the illegal trade of opium. During the assignment, he ordered the destruction of opium being stored there. According to Chinese law, the British had no legal right to store opium in China, but the stocks of opium were technically the property of British merchants. The destruction of British property by the Chinese became the pretext for a war that primarily was about Britain's frustrated desire for trading rights with China. British naval superiority overtook the Chinese, and the Treaty of Nanjing was signed after 3 years of conflict in 1842. The treaty was the first in a long series of what the Chinese referred to as the unequal treaties.